Jill Bolte Taylor, when she had her stroke, when she came back, she wasn't herself. Like, she remembers, like, not even she remembers. She doesn't remember her mother. She doesn't remember anything about her past life. I don't know how come she remembered her experience of having the stroke, but she remembers, like, those parts of it. Because you talked about this yesterday. You said the me needs to know that it exists and it needs to. But then when you, in her case, her that she was before, her memories, her experience, everything that she's learned is gone. Do you understand? Because it's not there anymore. So why is me, and that's when I fall asleep at night, sometimes I think about this, is like, why am I so important? Not so important, not phrasing it properly. Why do I need
to survive? Said that just right. You know, you probably could have said, why do I have this role? It feels very ordinary because you're doing your thing, you like what you're doing, et cetera. That is the way it should be. If you're out there on soapbox and you think you're, you know, you got to preach to the world, I am the savior of the world, that's not going to be the right attitude or the right approach. It's going to be just ordinary people doing their thing. And coming together and saying, well, you know, I'd like to get involved in that, or I'd like to have a say in that, or I will do such and such to help that along, or whatever. And it'll be something you like to do. It'll be something you're good at.
You know, I keep thinking, I came here, I struggled, I found it hard, and the idea of dying and coming back and start over was, but then I had these thoughts of, do I really need to survive? Who remembers me? You understand? If I die, what is the purpose of my experience? Does it really matter? That's more what I mean. Why? It's not really important. Everybody has experience. I have the same fears as everybody else. I have the same.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm formulating my question properly. What is so important about creation? Who remembers? There's no father, mother figure going, oh, you know, I really appreciated that what this creation did. You know, it was a nice experience. Like, Jill Bolte Taylor, her past person that she was, is gone. Who remembers that person? It's gone. She's somebody else in the same body, because whatever memory she had, the consciousness, just went, where did that go? Okay. What was the purpose of that? Do you understand?
Was the purpose? I do. So let me say something about the way the brain works and is organized. So your brain is organized kind of like computer files. And all of the colors are in one drawer, one area. All of the fruit is in another drawer. All of the types of clothing are in another drawer. And they'll be arranged in a chronological order. And that order is going to be the order in which that thing, that color, that fruit, that person, that clothing came into your life. And so what you'll see, what you'll hear, sometimes is when a mother gets excited and she's trying to yell at one of her kids, and she's got six kids, or I'll use my kids. You know, I've got four children, and every so often I would get all upset with the youngest one, Nellie, and I would say, Nellie, and it would, you're going through in a hurried manner, and the computer is saying, is it Kelly? No. Is it Melissa? No. Is it Nathan? No. Is it Nellie? Yes. Oh, Nellie. And so, you know, you finish yelling or correcting or whatever it is. And so when a person has a stroke, if childhood memories at age 15 or 13 or 9 are all in one area, and that area is damaged, then that person no longer has access to that. So a person who has a stroke can have all their fruits wiped out, or their recognition and understanding of clothing could be gone, or family members could be gone, or colors, or whatever. So that's why she didn't have access to that information.
Where's the information? Does it serve a purpose? Just that information, that experience, is it still somewhere, or is it suddenly, well, it's corrupted, so now it's gone. Do you understand?
It is there. And you ask the question, you know, so what if I don't survive? Who cares? You care. When you are dead, when you've left the physical, and you discover, oh my God, I'm not dead, then all of the experience that you had is there for you to learn from, to draw from. So we set up these experiences that we hope will change us at the core and make a huge difference in how we see the world, how we respond to one another, how we create, etc. And that's what the experience is about. It doesn't matter whether your mother or father ever say another word to you, or whether they're with you on the other side and they pat you on the back and say, good job, I'm moving on. what matters is how you think and how you feel and what you can draw from that experience. If you say, well, that sucked, well, that's not very, maybe it did suck, but what else did you get out of that experience? And once you answer that, then you say to yourself, what else could I get out of that? And so the ability to keep on going back and extrapolating from that experience, learning, understanding, going deeper, that's really what the advanced consciousness is going to do. The okay. young, immature consciousness is just going to say, well, screw that. I'm out of there. You know, I'm not going there again. That okay. kind of thing.
Jill Bolte Taylor, when she will pass on from this body, or maybe she'll have a kundalini and bring her body with her, do both her lives, will she remember everything? Do you understand? Yep. Like those experiences. Okay, so it's not lost. It's still no. part of her frequency. It's just not accessible at this time because of her brain, because there was something.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And here's another factor. When you have a stroke, for instance, or you have a car accident, you have brain damage, or whatever, what actually gets disturbed is the programming of the various columns. They're called columns in the brain. The information is not in the actual brain. It's out there in the field. And the thing to be aware of, and I think I've said this before, is that every single thing that happens is imprinted in that field and it's there forever. And so when you lose your, it's a little bit of intuition one. So the brain gets imprinted it has millions of columns in it, and every column tunes itself to a particular frequency of light in the areas that are occipital, because that's what's paying attention to light waves. Sound is right here, you know, in the auditory lobes. Movement, et cetera, is in the sensory and motor lobes. And so those columns tune themselves to a particular frequency. And so when you see a cat, for instance, there's a light coming off that cat from every direction at different frequencies. And each one of those directions or vectors is going to strike the eye, get referred through the optic nerve to the thalamus, and then get referred eventually back to the occipital lobe. And that, and there'll be one column per frequency. And so later when you see a cat, that whole pattern in the brain lights up. If something like a stroke disturbs your ability to retrieve the pattern, that memory is gone. It isn't that the information is gone. It just means that your brain structure is no longer when my mother had a motorcycle accident, which is, it's just so funny for her. She's this little farm girl with six kids, and she has this motorcycle accident, and which my dad had moved. He had got a job in another part of the country, so they're living in separate places until school is over. The last day of school, she's taking my brother somewhere, and she says, I'll take you on my little, she has this motor scooter. She didn't know how to drive it, and she hit the dust, and she cracked her skull, and it was really bad. But all of her information was scrambled. And that was June 1st, maybe 1968 when that happened, 69, something like that. It was September before she was able to get some of the information back in the drawers correctly. In the meantime, the conversations with her were absolutely hilarious because she had all these pieces all connected wrong. And we spent hours talking with her and sharing, no, that doesn't go with that. That, you know, that didn't, that goes over here. And anyway, that was one of the things that got me interested in the brain, brain structure and function, and then Kundalini did the rest of the work. So I think it's really important to understand that everything that happens is imprinted in the field, and when you have a memory, what you do is retune or retrieve that pattern of frequency recognition and project it out there in the field. And try to retrieve that memory. That's how memory actually works. You try to re-trigger the pattern of frequencies that were imprinted in the brain. And when you need to, you can go back into the field and retune. And you have to get into an altered state. So people say, let's do hypnosis. Why does hypnosis work? Because it moves a lot of everyday stuff out of the way, and you can go back to that moment and retrieve that information from the field and restore or reaffirm the frequency retrieval that you're trying to get to.